session.
Okay.
You can have a seat if you want.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. It's okay. I can stand. Okay. This is one of this is the Mongolian capital, which is one of the biggest city. There are like two more, which are not really big as the capital city.
But even before this terrible winter happened, were the cities existing before
this? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Because, yeah, I think you saw that picture because some people, if you talk about Mongolia, they will think about maybe the people who is riding horse and who is herding goats and sheep, and that's it. So there is also the capital, which is like half of the half mil, 1.5 million people are staying there, but it's like exactly other countries, like it's really westernized kind of, and yeah. So it's not like Mongolia is not like everywhere herding goats and sheep and yeah. So I don't know how to really. Yeah.
Prior to the winter,
mm-hmm.
what percentage of people were nomadic out of the population of Mongolia? Did they mostly live in the cities and were the nomads dwindling before that, or are most people nomadic?
It's I don't know how many percent, but probably, I don't know, 20? What do you guys think? They're also maybe 20, yeah. They're also from Mongolia.
So half or half, I think 5%, 3% of people like really nomadic. And 25% or 50% of people are really nomadic. And 10% or 50% of people, they live in like small village.
Semi-nomads.
Yeah, not a big city. There's, I mean, there's a lot of small villages. So sometimes they, you know, they still have horses and sheep and all this stuff, but they do really, like, they're really, really nomadic.
Yeah, kind of semi-nomads. Yeah.
So half of the population live in the capital city. It's called the Bamba. Half of the population.
Yeah.
It's a huge number.
Yeah. So it's like really. Okay, Mongolia is really, really, Mongolia put education in a period, because I remember in 2010, like 87% of the Mongolian people get educated, so 87%. So they really focus on to, especially nomads, really focus on to educate their children. So, they send their children when it's like 6 or 8 years old, I think now it's like 6 years old, to elementary school, secondary school and high school, and universities and colleges. So nomadic children go to school in the fall, September, until May. So during their winter and summer vacation, they will go to the countryside and help their parents. Yeah. 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 Yeah, they have dormitories. Yeah, also some of the families move to the city and yeah. Or they live in their relatives or friends' house or yeah. Hi.
Mm-hmm.
My mom still lives in a countryside, which is like 1,500 kilometers from the capital city, pretty remote area. So my mom works in a secondary school. She's not really nomad, but it's like kind of nomad. I don't know how to really explain it, yeah. But my family lost all their livestock, so I think we all only have maybe 10 or something like that, so compared to what we used to have before. So we don't have enough livestock to go and herd them, so yeah. I moved here 2.5 years ago, so I haven't back to my country yet, but yeah, I do, yeah. Yes.
You had the picture of the Dell, the dress.
Mm-hmm.
The one woman had, it looked like metal on her.
Oh.
Is that from military service or?
No, that's, okay, oops. Can I just save it?
Don't
save. Oh, never mind.
You can click out and don't save. So exit out again and don't save.
Oops. Okay, this is a picture. I went to my hometown before I moved here. So she's my mom. She got awarded this from government. It's like she was really hardworking and yeah. So yeah.
Sorry,
and that's
so
my.
Like Mongolia used to be part of the Soviet Union.
Mm-hmm.
And when we were Soviet Union, like a lot of people worked in the farm. If you're a really hard worker, you can get this, you know. So
for
it's
being
like
a
yeah. Okay. So for being a hard worker.
Yeah.
But every people have to do the year plan. So you have to accomplish the year plan. To accomplish it, and if you do it over, you can get it.
Yeah.
Or, you know,
yeah.
Overachiever, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. But my mom is used to work in a secondary school for like 37 years. So that's why she got awarded from the government. Yeah. Honored.
Yeah, when do you wear that dress?
That's a really good question. Yeah. Okay, in the countryside, people wear it like every day. But in the cities, just in a special occasion. But in a country, kind of not really countryside, it's in the villages and there's some centers, people wear it like normally, every day, kind of, yeah.
Did you go back to the map that you showed us in Arizona? I would love it if you showed people, because we've been talking about this in world literature.
Yeah.
Could you show where Asia begins and Europe ends? Because I think it's on this map.
Hmm.
Talk about different, Laura,
I think maybe it's in here, but I'm not sure.
It's right on the
yeah.
Lake, right, Laura?
Lake?
Well, it's the Bosphorus.
Yeah, this is
well,
this is Russia, and this is in Europe.
It's more like Turkey. So west
it's
of
back
Kazakhstan. Central
Tajikistan.
It's west
all,
of Kazakhstan.
Yeah, all the stuff.
It's like
so
over here.
Asia, and then you have Southwest Asia. So it's basically
so it's over there.
Turkey.
So it's like over here.
Okay. So east is Turkey and kind of Ukraine.
But Russia is in Europe.
Because I thought you were saying.
She's from Kazakhstan.
Yeah, but I thought she was talking about part is Europe and part is Asia, maybe I
was something different. No, maybe she was saying that
in
Kazakhstan, which is close to Europe,
yeah.
Maybe
very close.
Yeah, by some part of European culture, yeah. The style of maybe the degrees,
yeah.
Or the way they come from, but it's still considered Asia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you, of years ago, I had a student from Mongolia
mm-hmm.
for a couple of semesters, and he went back home one summer
mm-hmm.
because there's a huge yearly festival where they
during the summer, the Nadam.
Yeah.
Because
he went home one year just
mm-hmm.
for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Nadam is one of the largest Mongolian holidays. Like everybody celebrates it, especially they celebrate it for. There is a game called competition called like men's three games, which is like horse racing, and archery and wrestling.
Yeah.
So I just found out recently. I don't know. I'm Mongolian, but I didn't think about it. I was reading a book recently, and the reason these three sports are the men's three game is since Genghis Khan, the Genghis Khan's time. Those sports for the preparing for war, so it's like the training for war. So it's kind of it's like inherited so far. So people celebrate it like every year in July. So yeah, it's a really big celebration. Yeah, it's also at the same time kind of Independence Day celebration, right? Yeah.
I have a comment and a question.
Okay.
So my comment is that one of my very favorite authors of all time writes beautifully about Mongolia and also the same topic as you.
Ehrlich?
Okay. She spent a year living with the Mongolian nomads. Mm-hmm. She wrote a really, really beautiful piece that I think was published in, National Geographic, that one.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, that one. And she's also written an entire book. I'm not sure if it's centered exactly on Mongolian nomads, but it has the name Winter in the title. I'm forgetting the title because it's a whole book.
Okay.
So she's someone who, in everything she's ever written, you see her have this yearning to collapse with nature.
Mm-hmm.
She wants to be, but there's a line in one of her essays where she says that when she, the first time she ever went to Japan, she got down on her knees and she like just sniffed the ground.
Mm-hmm.
She's constantly being weird like that. She thinks
okay.
She's animal or she's
Okay.
She's got this thing where she really thinks civilization is a great curse, because it separated us from our natural roots, is kind of what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And so for me, and here's the question, that was the comment, here's the question. I spend 1 week a year living like a nomad.
Okay.
At this crazy festival called Burning Man.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've heard of Burning Man or not, but it's really been one of the highlights of my life.
Okay.
That festival. And when I saw, the reason I thought of Burning Man is I saw the beautiful inside of the dirt.
Yeah.
The yurt. And that's one of the things about Burning Man that's so amazing is people build these temporary structures for a week out of every year.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful like that.
Yeah.
I think a large part of why people go to this festival and why it's growing by the thousands every year is there's some piece of that nomadic life that is very spiritually, even for atheists, there's something really spiritually satisfying about living in a temporary environment.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really know exactly how to articulate me what's so powerful about living in a temporary environment, except that it causes you, it prompts some amount of humility and some sort of deference to the elements, because you're not so separate from them, and at any moment a dust storm could happen, at any moment you could have a real consequence of nature.
Yeah.
As protective as these structures are, they're still not these concrete buildings,
brick. Yeah.
You're not as divorced from the landscape.
Mm-hmm.
Every day at dusk, when the sun goes down, the entire community walks out of their yurts or whatever.
Yeah.
And the entire community cheers as one. Yay, it's the desert, it's going to be cooler now. And so I guess what I'm trying to ask is, what do you see as one of the, or a few of the essential things that we're losing to lose nomadic culture?
Nomadic culture?
Because you were saying it makes you sad. This is going to be a thing.
Yeah.
What are the essential things that you think are so sad for us to lose? The things that you grew up just knowing and being part of that you don't have access to?
Yeah. One of the things was, I mentioned also in my photo, which was like Mongolian people's hospitality. As I was growing up, it's like, for example, if people are moving one place to other place, Mongolian people prepare food for the people, even though they don't know those people, they prepare food and go to them and see them, and they like treat them, sit down and feed them. But recently, what I think is, in a city when it's like, I've been in city only 2 years, because I've been in Western Mongolia. I went to university in Western Mongolia and moved to city only for 2 years, so I moved here. But when I was there, I was thinking, people are getting like more suspicious. They're like really losing that real Mongolian like natural hospitality. Nobody will come and like, it's understandable, but it's still really sad, Yeah. So that's
exactly what it strikes me about my experience of Burning Man every year. It's not that Burning Man is like Mongolia, but in a civilized world, I have a note.
Yeah.
No knocking, no unexpected visitors, I'm going to be nappy, I don't want you here.
Yeah.
So when I'm at Burning Man, people run up the
into my camp with food.
Yeah, anytime,
and I'm like, yay, hi, who are you? Yeah. I'll be Joe Bond, and thank you for watermelon. And it's this community that happens that I think.
Yeah, so some people lock their door during the night in the countryside. Usually people really don't lock it. But if somebody come and knock your door during the night, middle of night, so you will get up and open it and make a food, like maybe 3 o'clock in the morning, like midnight, and it doesn't matter because you are my host, you are my guest. Yeah. I think that's really wonderful because no one really would get up and they were like, I don't want to open my door. Yeah, so. I wrote this paper on my English 121 class. Yeah, it was a photo essay. Yeah, so I was thinking what I'm gonna write, so I decided to write Mongol Nomads. So, yeah. Yep. Yeah. But this is just I prepared, but if you check it out my essay, the real original version, it's in a Clara. Yeah.
Yeah, it's in here and online.
Yeah. Yes?
Where did the photographs that you where did they come from? Did you take them or did you find them?
Photographs in this presentation?
Yeah.
I took them from National Geographic, and the only picture I took is those pictures taken some of my friends and myself. This is also taken by my friend. So, yeah, this picture also taken by my friend. Yeah. So some of them, but the photos I included my photo essay is all of them are taken by some of my friends and myself. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Going back to what Tina was saying about your appeal of nomadic culture, I think it maintains that reverence towards nature rather than the need to control and change it, which comes with urbanization. And to different pastures and whatnot, as opposed to forcing the land. Like, that's one of the big issues that we have in this country with farming. The way we treat our soil is why we have dust bowls, and I know China had a big issue with that too, and over-tilling soil.
And that's something Sean taught, which like what he's so nicely into, this is our say, check it out, you know, he wasn't here today, but check out his presentation online and the print version when it comes out, because it's exactly what he talks about, is the treatment of the soil and the treatment of the land.
Well, I was just going to say, I think the appeal comes from the fact that it really speaks to our evolutionary egalitarian nature, which really we haven't gotten past. We pretend we have, and we force agriculture. But if you look at human history, and actually I learned this in class, and it really, it's a very small footnote in our history thus far. Agriculture is, and before that we were more nomadic and egalitarian, and herding animals came before planting seeds, and so I think it really speaks to what we were designed to do, and I think that's why you probably enjoy bringing in so much that sense of community that you get from it, you can't have in an urban community. A lot of people fight really hard for it with communities and whatnot, but when you have nomadic societies, you don't have to fight for it. It just happens. Everybody holds their own weight.
The last panel, even something Patrick said, responded to that. It was a tiny little line out of your mouth in the last panel, Patrick, but it was about this the background of the civilization and all of this stuff going on. I think it's something that we all of us who think about our state as humans in the modern world, it's something a lot of us come back to, is this idea of our separation from nature, where we force nature. And, so I too hope that this isn't lost, you know, as the culture maybe.
That actually brings up something that's been kind of preying on my mind for a while, over the course of the presentation with the Zud and with the increased urbanization, all the nomads settling down outside the city. Where is their produce coming from? Where are they getting most of their food? Is it imported? Are there farms that are springing up that are stationary?
That's a really good question. Because, okay, Mongolian nomads herd goat and sheep. So Mongolians eat a lot of mutton and goat meat and also beef. So these all meat source comes from all from nomads, from countryside. And also nomads make like dairy products. So these also all sources come from countryside, from the nomads. So I also can see that if the urbanization is ongoing, they're really organic meat and organic source of dairy products will diminish. Probably they're going to use like harmonized like here, or like they're going to use something different, or like, I don't know. But that's also sad, yeah.
I think one of the best parts about raising animals with that kind of seasonal grazing too, is something that really frustrates me with how we treat our animals. Like, I saw a commercial actually, you know, praising the laurels of feeding animals corn and soy. They don't eat corn and soy. Chickens, they eat seeds and they go around, they eat grub. They don't have vegetarian diets. And cattle should be grazing on grasses. They should not be having this synthetic food that even we eat far too much of, and then we get more of it through the meat. So I think we're losing that herding lifestyle. It's very, very tragic.
Yeah,
again,
it is.
Back to what we should be doing.
Yeah, and
what about fruit and vegetables?
Mongolia is a pretty like semi-arid country. Like it's pretty really dry. We don't have a lot of areas we would grow. So usually we import from China. And their quality is not really good. Yeah, so, yeah.
So if they're moving here out of China, what are vegetables, potatoes, carrots, then grow in our land. But we can grow it. I mean, we can grow it in some part of our country, but we only grow it like from April to August. So
yeah.
We can grow it there, and when August comes, we take everything.
Growing season is pretty short. So what was your question?
Yeah, so if they keep moving, how do they get imported vegetables?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure they don't have the UPS or FedEx.
Yeah. People eat, like, they will go, there is, there is like a big city, then also a little bit smaller city, which is called province and Somme, so and countryside. So people, the nomads who live really, really countryside, they go to their Somme center and buy their some of their food supply. Yeah, supplies. Yep. Yeah.
So I believe you told me you're interested in petroleum engineering.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't know right now, but Yeah, I understand. I was working a mining company in Mongolia, and I get really interested in to be like mining engineering and geology. So recently I'm really interested in petroleum engineering. There is not a lot of oil and gas in Mongolia, but recently, one company from China explored one area. I don't know how it's going to go. But since I got a degree from here, I can work like all over the world. And while like I want to work like whatever I can get a job offer. So And whatever I learned, I would like to go back and teach the people if there is also still like petroleum industry and people really need it. Yeah. Or I might study mining engineering. I didn't really make mine yet. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
Time for a couple more comments or questions? Yeah.
So within like the major cities, like I'm not gonna try and pronounce that because I'll butcher it, but
yeah.
like larger major cities, do you think there's a kind of sense of a feeling of loss for the nomadic culture, like out in the countryside, or just kind of like, oh, that's our past, forget about it, we need to move on to bigger and brighter things?
I think so, yeah. Because like especially if you're like raised in the city, they will not really know what exactly nomadic life is unless they like go to the countryside and see the life, they will really don't know. I remember like little children, they're from city, if they go to the countryside they're afraid of goats and sheep. Like I wouldn't say there is a lot of ignorant.
Yeah, that was a bad word, actually.
Yeah.
But they're just not like very aware of like the situation.
Yeah. Yeah. There is a difference, yeah. If you're like grew up in a city and some people, yeah. So it's like
farm life and agriculture life in our literature and in our movies.
Mhm.
So I guess maybe another way to ask what he's asking is there some glorification? Like, oh, wouldn't it be nice to move to the country and experience that? Or is it more just this process of...
Sorry, I see.
Yeah.
I think it's more toward to the city because not really everybody wants to go and live in the countryside, but they like to go and travel and see the countryside, but they're not like...
They don't want to live there.
Live there, yeah. Because it's really hard, especially during the winter. Unless you have a lot of livestock, you're not going to do anything. So it's like really simple everyday life, but it's really unique and really wonderful. I love it. Yeah.
Do you know if that's something Mongolia is looking at as far as tourism goes?
Mm-hmm.
Like bringing people out into the countryside so they can see it and experience it?
Yeah. Yeah, there is tourism is really like increasing recently, like last few years. A lot of people are going to the countryside and exploring Mongolian Gobi Desert, and also the Altai Mountains, and yeah. Yep.
I just want to make a comment to that. One of my other students once did an adventure tour by horseback. And she was a very accomplished horsewoman,
mm-hmm.
and you know, I actually introduced her to my Mongolian students so she could talk to them before.
Yeah.
But the thing that astonished her, besides the hospitality,
mm-hmm.
was the fact that you could be literally out in the middle of nowhere,
mm-hmm.
and people will find you. You don't need FedEx. And all of a sudden, a Land Rover Jeep appears on the horizon. Oh, we heard you were here, and came to meet the group.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think Joanna can attest to it. I've had it happen to me in Africa,
mm-hmm.
where, you know, oh, where's that crazy American woman? You know, oh, yeah, she's down the road 10 miles, and then take a left.
They know where you are.
They know where you are.
I actually had the same experience down out in the middle of nowhere in Mexico.
In Mexico.
Really strange. Our car got stuck in the middle of nowhere. I centered it. We were trying to figure out what we were going to do, and then all of a sudden, this huge group of people came out of nowhere and helped us get the car out, and then went on our way.
Yeah. And that's that hospitality.
I know. I had it happen in Africa. My distributor or something fell apart in my car because of being jostled so much, and I had no idea. And somebody stopped, fixed it, would not take a cent.
Yeah.
In Swaziland, but my student came back and told me.
Yeah.
She had just constant experiences of people finding them out in the bush on their horses, and knowing that they were there and knowing
yeah.
right where to find them,
mm-hmm.
and then stopping and, mm-hmm. and having hospitality and some food and tea.
Yeah.
And she said it was just phenomenal the way people found them wherever they were.
Yeah.
Joanna really had me quote Shakespeare. ready for this child?
Yeah.
Well, it just reminds me of one of my favorite lines from Shakespeare, and maybe you'll be able to maybe play, because I forget which play it comes from, but there's something I'm really drawn to about the nomad lifestyle, as you've explained it, and as I've seen it explained again by Gretel Ehrlich, which has to do with this line from Shakespeare, which says, "We all know security is mortal's chiefest enemy." We all know security is mortal's chiefest enemy, and it's I don't know exactly how he was meaning it, but the way when people quote it now, a lot of what they're talking about is the more civilized we get, urbanized we get, and the more secure we feel, safe from the elements, the more we're losing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's stagnation.
Yeah. I think that's what Lauren was pointing out, that we, when we attempt to control
it's tempting to go a little too far with that sort of a thought, and definitely, you know, yay penicillin, and yay urbanization, and the way it's led to all of these sorts of advances in science, and certainly a lot of amazing things have come from people gathering in these beehive hubs of civilization. But I just really love your photo essay because it does give us a chance to think about what we might be losing if we're not careful.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that a lot of people don't really see these days. It's unfortunate that we kind of equate that sort of civilization and that urbanization with culture, and that's not the case. I mean, that's not the definition of culture. Absolutely.
Although it is natural too.
Yeah.
It is, like, again, the beehive. You know, it is something that humans do. They congregate in large groups.
Yeah.
But let's have one final comment, and then we'll probably break soon because you've been up there answering our questions.
I was going to say, I think the issue we have, like you said, penicillin was good, it was nature. We don't have a balance. It's always science or nature.
Yeah.
And so many doctors don't even, like, we went over it in human sexuality class, how many doctors have actually seen a natural birth? None of them.
Yeah.
And so we don't incorporate the things that have been working for thousands of years with new advancements.
Mm-hmm.
And we teach people to believe that new is better, and I think what we need is we need both.
And
we need to keep that foundation.
And what we call alternative medicine is the first medicine.
Yes.
You know, this Eastern medicine was around long before Western pharmaceuticals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think we need to complement it, because there's so many things you can do with homeopathics and diet that remove the need for pharmaceuticals, but at the same time, and things like penicillin and morphine when you're in serious agony. Like, there are points when all of these things are good. There are points when you need surgery rather than a walking bird, you know. But we need to find that balance again. And I really hope that Mongolia remembers that and that they preserve that nomad culture.
And also, don't think we can hold one culture responsible for, you're the only ones left. You just have to know, because everybody else went this way too. And,
yeah.
You know, it's, again, it's like, it's sort of a little bit much to expect one culture to stay some certain way for the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's on you, Mongolia. You have to preserve. You know, it's on all of us.
That's why we want you to go back.
But anyway, I want to thank you again.
Thank you so much. Thanks.
And all of us here today. It's been such a wonderful day. I've had such a good time not teaching class and writing papers. I hope all of you have learned.
Yeah.
And learning instead, you know, a little bit maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we'll let it end here, but feel free to mill a bit and talk a bit more if you'd like.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being here, and I really appreciate all your questions and comments. Hello, everybody. My name is Gantuya, Yanjinsuren. I'm an international student from Mongolia. I wrote a photo essay called Last Nomads, so I'm going to present today. Before I start, I want to ask a question. So how many of you guys know where Mongolia is? Yay! Cool, because I met not a lot, but some people who had no idea where Mongolia is. Like, is it like part of China, or is it an independent country? So. It's an independent country, and it has own culture, and also own unique culture. And okay, there's a map of Mongolia. It's a landlocked country between Russia and China. So it's an independent country, has in a different nationality than Chinese and other Asian countries. And also, I want to show you some of the Mongolian landscape. So this is the Mongolian steppe. I think you would see over here the nomads, like gir, which is known as a yurt for Western people. So there's some horse, and it's a Mongolian countryside. This is Altai Mountains. This is the tallest mountain in Mongolia, which is connect Russia and Kazakhstan and Mongolian border. So Gobi Desert, and so Mongolian camels has two humps. And this is Kuvsko Lake, which is second freshest water in Central Asia after Baikal. So it is really, really beautiful place. You guys should visit sometime. It's called like Mongolian Switzerland, so people call it. So this is my hometown. So I grew up in southwestern Mongolia, herding goats and sheep. When I was a little girl, I started to helping my grandma herding like baby goat and sheep and lamb, whatever. And like exactly like these children, like. So my mom was like semi-nomad, my grandma was like totally nomad. So during my school year, I used to go to my school, and during my winter and summer vacation, I used to go to the countryside and herd goats and sheep. Also when I was a little, I was like herding and playing with the baby goats and sheep like that, like these children. Okay, I would like to tell you about a little bit about who are Mongolian nomads. Mongolian nomads are really cheerful, strong, and hardworking people. There's a cheerful, strong person. they move like four seasons because of their livestock. So they have like summer camp, winter camp, and fall camp. And the reason they move is in order to lead their livestock into really good pasture. And also Mongolian nomads have their, like, not Mongolian only nomads, Mongolians have their own traditional clothes, which is called, I want to mention this too. These people are the reindeer nomads. They're really few ethnic groups in Mongolia. They're also really strong people, overcome really harsh Mongolian winter. So this is traditional dell. There I am. And Mongolian people has the traditional dell. It's called traditional clothes. It's called dell. So people recently make the dell in a different style and any kind of design, whatever they want. But this is the general design they make. And I would like to, so this is Mongolian gear, which is known as a yurt, as I mentioned before. People live in a yurt, Mongolian nomads live in a yurt, and they move like all season following their livestock. So it's really cold, especially during the winter, if you get up in a gear. It's like really freezing cold. It gets really warm fast, and it gets cold really fast. So this is the entire inside of the design of the gear. So people decorate inside of the gear. So it's really nice, really unique. Mongolian nomads also use their main transportation as a camel, because they have to move one place to other place. So over here, they're like throwing down their gear, and there's a little girl, nomad girl, and she's maybe their family ready to hit the road. So so they throw down all the gear and everything, and they load into the camel, and they move one place to other place. So recently, the number of the Mongolian nomads is diminishing because Mongolia had really bad, really, really hard winter in 2007, and they lost like 70 to 50% of livestock. This is a people moving. Nomads are moving. Oops. Nomadic families moving over here. This is because of this movement. There is a urbanization is ongoing in Mongolia. So I think you can see a lot of gear in over this area. So this is the capital, Mongolian capital. So it expanded like a lot. So Mongolia has only like 3 million people, but 50% of the Mongolian population live in a capital city, Yubi. So there's a lot of urbanization is going on. So the one reason of the urbanization was this dirt, which is really, really hard winter, killed a lot of animals. And also people are moving to the cities because they lost their livestock. They don't have anything to do. So they're looking for job in the cities. Also, they're like going to improve, like focus on their children's education. That's why they're also moving to cities. So you can see how it looks like in the countryside and like how it is like so crowded in the suburb area. So this is UB. So if you look at this picture, I think you would think about it like any city in the world, probably. I don't know, because it's like a lot of lights, and you would not really like identify is it like really Mongolia or not. So if you go back and look at to the previous pictures, the Mongolian landscape and Gobi Desert and everything, you would know like, okay, it's kind of different country. It's probably Mongolia or whatever. So what I wanted to tell you is Mongolian nomads' lifestyle is changing because of this westernizing and urbanizing, and also really bad winter also influenced the people's lifestyle. So Mongolian nomads has been one of the few nomadic people on the earth who has been kept their culture until today. So I don't want, of course I don't want, but I really want to tell you guys, if this urbanization is ongoing and people are like building a lot of houses and also a lot of buildings in the cities, all the nomads move into the city, there will not be a Mongolian nomads. Like, who were they? They're gonna be like the thing in the past. So as I was growing up in a nomadic family, it's really important for me the nomadic culture, and its uniqueness will always I will always carry with myself. But if it keep going like this, it's gonna be the thing in the past. So thank you so much for being here, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Yeah.